Good morning. Thank you for your kind invitation. Very first thing I'm going to ask you to do is to turn to the person next to you and share your favorite smell. What is your favorite smell? You have 33 seconds to do this. You can begin. All right, I will interrupt you and thank you for the way you jumped in. And you're wondering, what in the world does that have to do with anything? Well, first of all, I got everybody thinking, talking, and listening. And as a speaker, I got a feel for what type of a group I have, whether they're very withdrawn and non-responsive or whether they're going to really get with it and everything. And the second time we meet, then we would talk about what's your favorite taste and what's your favorite touch. And we go through all the senses. And when you do group work, it's amazing what you can learn when you get people talking about their senses. Now, I have a second question. I'd like you to turn to the person next to you and ask the question, how are you doing today? And then answer it. You can begin. Now turn back to that person and ask the question, but how are you really doing? Thank you. Again, I will interrupt you. The reason for that question is that we live in a culture that does not teach about loss or grief. And we've learned very glibly to just respond, oh, everything's fine, everything's going well, instead of being honest and saying, I'm struggling today. Thank you for asking. And those are very, very important questions. My background is I grew up in Hollywood at the Hollywood Presbyterian Church, went to SC, Westmont, Pepperdine, Fuller. And the first major crisis that I think I really experienced was when I went on staff of my church. I was called to be the Christian Ed Director, and I did not read the fine print that said youth pastor. And it was a church of 1,400 members, 300 teenagers, and the senior pastor and I were the staff. That's the way it was in the 60s, folks. Not one person for every 120, but you did everything. I've been in ministry now 55 years. I still teach, counsel, do debriefings, write, and that's basically enough about me. We're talking today about loss and grief and trauma. I have no idea how far I'm going to get. I have a terrible problem with mechanical things, keeping track of time, but just about everything that I'm going to be covering is printed out, and I've taught graduate school for 50 years, and I believe in homework, and you will have several handouts to go back over so you don't have to write as much. Some of the things you'll see where you need to write. And then I will be making reference to a number of books because I really believe it's so important that you fill the reservoir within you. And when you do that, with the guidance of the Holy Spirit and the Word, then you're able to really share and connect with people. And I'm going to give a number of examples of that. So these are two of my dogs. One has died recently, but I've had four different golden retrievers. And just recently, last month, I spoke for the Lutheran denomination in Chicago, and I had 350 people in the class and 80 golden retrievers. I never heard one bark all day long from those dogs. They are comfort dogs. They have been highly trained to go out and minister. And what's interesting is that they, as a group, was the only Christian group that responded to the tragedy in Orlando, Florida. What does that say? And there are a dozen dogs there just helping the individuals through their grief process. And I've used them before. I've used mine for family counseling as well. Let me put you into a situation and see what you would do. You've been asked to work with a family, grandmother, mother, and a 13-year-old. And they came in to see you. And the 13-year-old was at the movie theater in Aurora, Colorado. The family had asked her to come and help babysit the children. And so she sat there while the little girl next to her was shot and killed. Mother was shot and wounded. Somebody else was shot and killed. And the boyfriend of the mother was shot in the head. How do you minister to this family? Well, let me tell you what happened. They came in, and I had been asked to meet with them. And the little girl sat with her back toward me. Wouldn't respond. Finally, after 20 minutes, she got up and said, "I am so sick and tired of telling this story to the news people, to the police and everybody. I just can't handle it anymore," and left, which was okay. And so I worked with the mother and the grandmother on how to get this little girl back into the school, because she'd not been back to school. And they happened to mention that at home they had a golden retriever, and they had met some dogs in the park, and that little girl responded. Well, after about 25 minutes, she walked back in, sat with her arms like this, back to me. So I just said, "Here, you got a golden retriever at home?" "Yep." "Well, I've got two of them. Here they are." And I had this picture in my Bible. And I said, "Here they are." She turned and looked at him. "Oh, yeah." I said, "That's Shadow and that's Aspen." "Really?" "Yeah." And we started talking and chatting about them. And Aspen is always getting into something. And she laughed a little bit and turned more and started to connect. And I said, "Yeah, in fact, I made a mistake. I was reading a novel, and I had it on the floor in my office. And Aspen came in and saw it, and he ate the last 5 pages. Oh, bummer. You know, I wanted to finish the novel, and he ate it." And she started laughing and everything. She says, "But the next day, I found him. And I read the last part of the novel." Yes. And she went, "Oh, gross." But by that time, she's laughing, and we're connecting and everything. And that's one of the things you do when you're working with somebody in grief or trauma. You find some way to connect with them. And I'll try just about anything, because I've had all sorts of different situations doing debriefings cross-culturally and in all sorts of settings. Well, let me share with you some material about loss in the family. Relax. You don't have to write it down. It's printed out. You can go back and read it, but I want to just get you to think about, what is this like ministering to families in the time of loss? Loss and trauma in the family. It's usually not one person impacted by a death, but an entire family unit. Unique problems arise. The balance of the family system is disrupted. And then what if you got a situation where a family member is terminal? I went through that for 4 years with my first wife, Joyce. Brain tumor. And your whole system starts getting a little disrupted. The other thing is, be thinking about, how would you feel? How would you feel if you had to work with people in this situation? How are you going to handle it? Because it has an effect upon you. There's something that we call secondary traumatization, where you pick up the trauma of that person and carry it around. And you've got to find some way to get rid of it. We all have our own ways. Okay, each member of the family unit differs in his response and even acceptance of the news. Some members will respond well to the needs of the dying person, while others would rather not acknowledge the impending death. Just don't want to talk about it. No, no. And how do you help people talk about it? What if a parent dies? That's a big hole. What if a child dies? Do you know it takes usually about 6 to 10 years to stabilize after the death of a child? It's been 27 years since my son Matthew died. I still get ambushed a couple times a year. And when it happens, I just accept it, and I'd rather have that occur than to be numb. You will become aware of the uniqueness of people's responses, and the fact will stretch you and your ability to assist them. You know what? I've been counseling forever, it seems like. And I'll have to admit, there are times I have no idea what to say. I don't know where to go with this. But that puts us dependent upon the Lord and say, "Lord, give me the words and the insight." You know, I work and do a lot of training of people in this field of counseling, and they're always saying, "What am I going to do?" Relax. You don't have to be concerned about what you do, because you pick up what they share with you, and that way you are going to go ahead and be able to connect. You learn from the person. I've had 9 years of college. I don't know how many seminars I've been to. I don't know how many hundreds of books that I've read. But let me tell you, where I've learned the most about counseling is not from that stuff. It's from every counselee that I've seen. And when a counselee comes in, part of my attitude is, they are going to teach me. I'm going to learn from them. And that is where I have learned the most. See them as your teachers. And don't worry about what you're going to say. No matter whether you meet with a family of three or four or a group of eight or ten, each one is going to respond in a unique way, even though they've all been exposed to the loss. And you wonder, how come they all respond differently? You got personality, you got DNA, you've got life experiences, all that stuff that goes on. Now, but have they really been exposed to the same loss? Perhaps, but perhaps not, because different relationships have different experiences. It could be that you've already experienced this in some of your own events. Each person's grief response is affected by numerous factors. It helps to look at a mourner and realize all that has come into play, especially when you're working with a family, and I've got several examples of that. Part of the difficulty will be family differences to the event, such as it doesn't help to talk about it. You can talk about it, but not with me. Let's just move on. We're doing fine. Fine. Thanks for asking. What does fine mean? If you're not sharing feelings, you're not responding in a healthy way. Let's let others help us. That is good and positive. When a family member is traumatized, the family balance is disrupted. There's a hole in the fabric of the family, but not everybody understands it. If one member is traumatized, so are the others. Keep that in mind. Different level of traumatization, but it is still there. Let me just find out where I am. I do a number of debriefings for banks. When there's a robbery, I get called in. In fact, I remember the first time that I had to go do a debriefing, I came home and was sharing with my wife, and I said, you know, I really enjoy doing those bank jobs. And she said, I think you need a different terminology there rather than bank job. But what happens is that people will be there, and they're traumatized, and then they go home to a family that's expecting them to function like they usually function. Get the dinner ready, do this, clean up this and everything. And we have to help them say, here's what to say to your spouse and to the children so that they can handle what's going on with you. And in that way, they end up, being a little bit traumatized. But that's what occurs. What happens if you have a situation with a terminal illness? This is very, very difficult for many because you know what the ending is going to be. But there's nothing that you can do to change the ending at this time. A couple of the resources that I will be talking about deals with this whole area of when somebody is terminally ill. Now, let me keep on this. Some of the unique problems to consider in the family system are: how close was each family member to the dying person? What was the quality of their relationship or level of attachment? Some are very close and enmeshed. Some are distance. How do you respond to each one? That's what you're going to be doing. And again, remember, this is printed off. You don't have to try to take any notes on this. What is the grieving pattern of each person, and what does each know about grief? Some of them are going to be what we call instrumental grievers. These are people who grieve with the left side of their brain. They talk about it. They think about it. They're very cognitive. Others are going to be intuitive grievers. Feelings are a very big part of it. Emotions are a very big part of it. So you got two different people there, and each has to be acknowledged and realize that it's okay for them to grieve in their own way. Because maybe they're looking at one another and say, you're not grieving right. You're not grieving right. What is right about it? One thing that you want to get across to everybody: never compare your grief with anybody else. I say that to everybody I'm working with. Don't compare it, okay? It's going to be different. It's going to be unique. To what extent does each person want to be involved with the dying person at this time? I've had some individuals that just walk out and shut the door and they never go back. Others don't even want to leave to go to the bathroom because they're afraid that when they're in the bathroom, the person is going to die and they're not going to be there at the time of the death. And so you got a real mixture here, and this is why you're going to end up feeling like a juggler. Oh, speaking of juggling, one of the things that I'm trying to do, because I'm getting a little bit older, is brain exercises to stretch the brain and keep it young, because we know that the brain can form new pathways and everything. And I have several ways of doing that. One is playing the piano, which I've done all my life. So I'm finding new music. I'm actually now working on Jerry Lee Lewis's kind of music, and I grew up classical, which is really different, but it's stretching it. But then I read one of the good things to do is learn how to juggle. Really? Okay, so I got some balls to juggle, and one of the first things I learned is do not juggle in a room where you have a low ceiling fan. Okay? Whew, man, that thing went like a rocket when it hit that up there. So I don't know how I got there. So a little tangential then. How does the expression of grief affect the grief of other family members? If somebody is crying a great deal and they're more of an instrumental, they don't want to be around. They're very uncomfortable with this. How will the family handle the after-death issues if there are differences as to what type of funeral, disposal of remains, type of service, disbursement of clothing and personal effects, photographs shown or not shown, holidays, anniversaries? That is a big area. I had one family where one of the parents could not handle seeing pictures of their child. But the other person wanted all the pictures up. And so they split the living room where there were pictures over here on this wall and over here, none whatsoever. What do you do with the clothing? You've got to help the person who is in grief deal with all sorts of outside suggestions, because they'll have people say, get rid of everything. Get the clothes out of there right now. Others will say, keep them as long as you want. So you have to teach them how to handle all these unsolicited suggestions, because that puts a lot of pressure on them. What are the specific reasons for the grief of each family member? What is it that they are grieving about the loss of the loved one? And you could be surprised by some of the stuff you will hear. Okay. I'm going to give us a case study, and then I'm going to put you to work to figure this out. So here is the case study we're going to talk about. The parents, as well as three siblings of a 23-year-old woman, came in for grief counseling. All were neat, well-dressed, and fairly quiet. The parents were first to speak about their daughter. They began with a description which characterized her as a quality young woman, their firstborn in the family. She was gifted in every area of her life and had a bright future ahead of her. That's part of the background. The parents went into great detail about her abilities and accomplishments, stopping every now and then because of their inability to talk. Often, all five were in tears. 2 weeks prior, this daughter and her 7-month-old unborn child and her mother-in-law were driving on a freeway when a truck struck and killed all of them. Since that time, every member of this family has been struggling. Here are the questions, and these questions are printed out for you on your paper. How would you begin this session? Describe your exact words. What would be your goal in this initial session? All of you in this side of the room, those are the two questions for you to talk about in a small group. In the center, you will talk about what would you say or ask to engage the three siblings? What would you want them to take away from this session in a tangible way? Those are the two questions that you are to brainstorm and talk about in your small group. And the last two questions will be to my right. Based on this information, identify all the possible grievers. What are the factors which contribute to this loss being a complicated grieving process? So you've got those questions printed out on your fill-in outline. Get together, maybe three or four in a group, and take a few minutes and come up with your answer, and then I'm going to walk you through this, and we'll learn about grief counseling with this case study. You can begin. Thank you for the way that you jump in and think and talk. One question. Let's say that you were the person that they have come to see. How would you feel? Could I see some hands? What kind of feelings would that evoke within you? Could I see some hands? Yes.
I think of my sister who passed away and I feel sad.
So it could activate unresolved losses in your life, right? That's something to be aware of. And what's interesting is that I think what happens is that when we bury a loss, we usually bury it alive. We don't deal with it. And God in his wisdom brings somebody in to see us that has the very same issue. And we're faced with, uh-oh, guess I better deal with this myself. That can happen. That can happen. There'll be a lot of feelings that different cases bring out in you. But it's an opportunity for growth. Now, in counseling all the cases, let me tell you the two textbooks on counseling. One is The Complete Guide to Crisis and Trauma Counseling. Because this, you need to devour again and again. On the books that I ask people to read in my classes, I go back and I reread my own books every year. Because I've forgotten what I wrote. You know, people come up and said, you said this in this book. I did. I don't remember that. I don't even remember the book. You know? So, but I do. And you devour it. Second book is Helping Those in Grief. This is the sequel to this. This book has a lot of case studies and actual verbatims. Because the best way to learn how to counsel is by reading verbatims or watching live counseling. That's how. My counseling, my teaching changed drastically in the 60s. Because I took a class from William Glasser, who wrote the book Reality Therapy. And I had him in my classes. We went to his home. And just a delightful fella. And he changed my counseling, or my teaching, because he brought live people into his class and counseled them. I said, oh my goodness. So I went back and changed it. And I had my live clients come in and didn't put a hindrance to them at all. I mean, if they wanted to cuss, they cussed. They ripped. And the students were like, wow. I'm saying, yes, this is the real world, folks. This is the real world. So, anyway, these are the materials to devour. And that way you're going to feel a little more secure, because I think I remember talking about that or reading about that. Now, looking at this case, because I'll come back and talk about this stuff later, let's see what we would do in this. After greeting each person, I would validate the fact that they have experienced a great loss in their life. If I didn't know already, I would ask the name of the daughter as well as the mother-in-law, and whenever I made reference to either, I would use their name rather than refer to them in a general way. That is very critical, because one of the fears that people have is that their loved one is going to be forgotten. And so you make use of that. I purposely try to do that. And that way it locks it in for me as well. One of the first questions I ask is, tell me about Janice. I'd like to hear about her. Because when you're doing grief counseling or trauma counseling, basically the first thing you always do is to say, tell me your story. And then you listen. And the greatest gift that you can ever give is the gift of your presence and your listening. Listening means that when you are talking, or when that person is through talking or talking to you, you're not thinking about what you're going to say. Just relax. You don't have to capture it all. And in terms of listening, there's three levels. Listening has content. Your content, or the person's content, makes up 7% of the message, and that's it. Wow. Tone of voice makes up 38%. But nonverbals makes up 55%. The greatest organ of listening is not your ears, it's your eyes. Watch them. Comment on what you're seeing. Bring that out. So you listen, true, with your ears. You listen with your eyes, but you also listen with your heart. And when you listen with your heart, that's when you make yourself vulnerable to be experiencing pain. Because sometimes you connect so much with them. I cry often with my counselees. Especially when I'm working with somebody who's lost a child. Now I handle it pretty well most of the time. But it's when they bring the picture in. Like this morning. Because that, now there's a face, and it becomes very, very real. And I know that's my trigger point, and that's okay. So be aware, you connect with your listening. That is so important. Here I want every member of the family to respond. Remember how many family members there are? There's five. There's parents and there's three kids, three teenagers. And so I would like them to go ahead and respond. Then, too often children are left out of the interaction. Always look for the forgotten grievers. You know when Katrina happened, you know who the biggest group of forgotten grievers was? I ask people that question. They say, oh, the first responders, on and on and on. Actually, it was the newscasters. You could see it on their face. They were left out of the equation. They could hardly talk at times. So after each has responded, my next question is, would you describe for me what the last 2 weeks has been like so that each has a chance to tell their story? Within this, I often ask how they heard the news and to describe their reaction, because maybe the whole family wasn't told at one time. Maybe it was piecemeal. My goal is to have them all tell their story and then normalize for them what they are experiencing and educate them about grief and what to expect in the future. And we use a handout on the crazy feelings of grief, which I'll go over with you and which you will have. This is what you do in all of your counseling. You have them tell their story. You normalize for them what they're experiencing because they think they're going crazy. Nobody told them about grief, and so I'm going over the edge. Then you educate them. Three steps. Get those three in. Tell me your story. Normalize for them. Educate them about the future. And that gives you your beginning right there. I want to find out about their support system as well as give some suggestions to eliminate the pressure of other individuals. I'll ask the question, who would you like to walk alongside you during this different time? Let's make a list here now. And that's really important that when you're working with somebody in grief, you always put things in writing, because the minute they walk out the door, they have forgotten everything that you said. So it's got to be in writing. And so we'll make a list of who are the people that you'd like to be there. What is your reason for having them? Oh, they do this and this, this, this. Okay, now we've taken care of them. Who are the people you don't want around you? And sometimes they look at me like, I don't believe you asked me that question. Yeah, I got to ask it, because there's people out there you don't want to talk to. You don't want them talking to you. You don't want their input. Who are they? And so we make a list. Now, how are you going to handle it when they call and make this suggestion? And we come up with a phrase, and we have that phrase printed out on a little card right next to the phone so that when this person calls, they don't have to fumble around. They can just look it up and say, well, thank you for your suggestion. I'll think about that and let you know. Well, thank you for your suggestion. I'll think about that and let you know. You know, the old broken record technique. But it keeps you in control, and they need that kind of help because they cannot think. They're not functional at this time. This is not just a loss. This is trauma. That's what this is. Okay. I also mentioned that each of them may grieve in different ways and with a different intensity. That's okay. It's not a sign that the other person doesn't care if their grief is less intense. I ask, how can the other family members support you at this time? Now, let's talk about differences. I'm sure all of you are familiar with the terms extrovert and introvert. Now, when people come in, and I don't know them, I don't know whether they're an extrovert or an introvert. You know, extroverts are those that you ask a question, they open their mouth, it comes out, they don't know what they're going to say until they hear themselves say it. They tend to exaggerate. And they think the whole world is their friends and everything. I mean, if you've got a kid that's an extrovert, you have no family secrets. Because they've shared them all. But that's what extroverts are like. You can ask them a question and they just go off. Not so with introverts. How many of you here believe that your preference is that more of an introvert rather than an extrovert? Okay. Now, introverts do not like to be the center of attention. However, I'm going to violate that right now. Your first name, sir? Fred. Okay, Fred, if I came to you and said, Fred, I got a question and I'm really interested in what you think about this. Here's the question. What do you think? What does that do to you? It puts you on the spot. It does a brain warp, huh? Lobotomy. Yeah. Okay, Fred, if I came to you and said, Fred, I have a question and I'm interested in your response to this. Here it is. You think about it, and when you're ready, let me know. How does that feel? That felt good. It felt good because I honored and respected your uniqueness as an introvert, because introverts need to think in order to speak. You put pressure on them and wah, they can't respond. And so if you came in and I don't know you, I'm going to make the assumption to begin with that you're more of an introvert until I'm taught otherwise. And that way I would ask you, here's something I'd like you to think about. And you do that especially with teenagers. And that makes a big difference. It's really interesting about introverts because they are so good at carrying on conversations in their mind between themselves and other people. They think that it actually happened. Don't you remember? We talked about that last week. Where was I? Gee. Yeah. So you have to take that into consideration. It could be also a very different cultural situation. I work with victim relief chaplains, and we're the chaplains for the Kern Medical Center. And we had a situation with a Muslim family about organ donation recently. And so we had to look at it from their cultural perspective to see whether this would be all right or not. And so there's a lot of things that come into play at this time. Okay, I get off on my tangents again. Some of the questions directed toward the parents could be asked of the siblings. I also let everybody know that I would be willing to meet with each one individually. One reason for this is that the deceased was described as special, gifted individual. But was she in the eyes of the siblings? I don't know. Sometimes, even in the initial session, I ask for a favorite memory from siblings. Memories are so important. And one of my suggestions would be, you know, every time you have a memory of your daughter, Janice, write it out. Keep track of these, because what you have now are memories. And they're very sharp right now. They're very even raw, maybe even painful. But a year or two from now, they have faded. They're distant. And you're going to think, oh, what was that that I wanted to remember about her? I had a guy that came into me that I worked with for a couple years, the loss of his wife. And he said, Norm, I'm keeping a list of 1,000 one-liners. What are you talking about, Dave? Well, every time I remember something about my wife, I write it on a 3x5 card, and when I get to 1,000 of these, I will stop doing that, because by then I've collected all the memories that I want. Wow. And that has helped a number of people, because once again, you learn from your clients, your counselees. Some may have a mixture of feelings. At some point, I would ask the parents and siblings alike if there's any unfinished business or issues between them and the deceased, or if there's something they wish they could have said to her before she died. If so, I would suggest writing a detailed letter and reading it aloud at the place of interment. It's very important that they be able to get it out. Now, I might be at this point in the first session. I might never get here. It depends on everyone, because everybody's going to be different. I'd like each one to believe there will be help for all of them during the months and years ahead of them. Any suggestions or recommendations made need to be put in writing. The list of crazy feelings. I would give one a copy of Experiencing Grief and suggest they read it when they're ready. This is the book right here that you carry with you in your purse, your attaché case. You have several copies. Always have this available. And I would say, as I work with Fred, and this is going to teach Fred not to sit in the front row, especially being an introvert, so. But Fred, here is a book that might help, and read it when you're ready. And after you read it and you realize, I don't remember anything, that's normal. And after you read it the second time and you still don't remember anything, that's okay. That's grief talking, okay? Use this. I carry it with me when I travel, because I'm a big eavesdropper. I'll listen to people in the airport. Happened yesterday. I'm at the security, you know, where you put the stuff in and it goes through. And once you get to a certain age, you don't have to take your shoes off. Problem is, I got metal in my shoes, so still does. So there's a lady in front of me, a lot of stuff going through, and there's two very beautiful boxes. Nice covering to them, wood. And then there's a nameplate on one. And I noticed these, and then I sort of leaned forward and read the name of a man, June 6, 2016. And so the lady looked up, and I said, are these urns? She says, yes. My son was killed. He was 20, 6'4", going to go to Harvard to play football, and he wanted to go to spend a year working down in Australia, and he was killed. I turned around, opened my case, handed her this. And I wish you could have seen the expression on her face. Oh, thank you. She was in agony. So we went through, all the stuff went through that machine, and she's pulling it together. And I said, I noticed there's two boxes. She said, yeah, because in Australia, what they do is that they cremate the coffin and put it in a separate container. And then she said, because we were just moving different places, I went by myself. My husband couldn't make it. And I don't know that if that was because of his work or because the trip. But I thought, so she had to go by herself to a foreign land and handle this. But at least she went away with this. You want a pile of these because they will be going left and right. Two-page chapters. It's simple. It doesn't overwhelm them. But the instructions that you give them are important. Read it when you are ready, because they have other people harping. You need to do this, you need to do that, this. No, they don't need that pressure. Okay. I also let them know that it's normal not to remember what they read at this time. I sent home a DVD called Tear Soup. Tear Soup is 16 minutes. And it normalizes and educates you about grief. I have used this with hundreds of families. In fact, I probably have about 50 of these floating around Bakersfield somewhere that I'll never get back. Because the people say, oh, we got family coming in this weekend. We want to watch it again. Or I got a neighbor down the street that just lost somebody. They need to see this. There is a paper in here which gives a whole bunch of questions for men, for women, for families, for children. Best resource that you can live. We've got this being shown in some of the high schools in Bakersfield because I've had a chance to train the counselors there, and they're using this, and the kids respond to it so well. So it's called Tear Soup. Incidentally, you all have an order form, and so if you want to, you can keep track on there because it describes everything, and I'll describe how to get the materials later on. Okay. There are two other family members who were lost as well. I bet we forgot that. It'd be easy to ignore them and gloss over this loss. I would ask about them as well as the effect this loss is having. And for the parents, the loss is a grandchild, which is major. The possible grievers would include husband, aunts, uncles, cousins, friends, fellow workers, pastors, church, OBGYN, husband's family, grandparents, truck driver, and similar groups of individuals. It's important to consider who's going to minister to them and how. Wow. We're talking about dozens of people, folks, and I'm just dealing with one family. There's the other family as well. And so you have to look at them and say, okay, who ministers? One of our tasks is to identify neglected grievers and reach out to them. We use the experiencing grief and the tear soup as well. Not only was this a sudden death, but it was a multiple tragedy involving someone's child, an unborn grandchild. There could be the possibility of legal complications because it was a vehicular accident. The way in which the notification was made could be a factor as well. You see, when you get the legal world involved, it prolongs the grieving process because it takes a minimum of at least 2 to 3 years before this will ever come to trial. And then the newspaper picks it up, and then the newscast picks it up, and people are re-traumatized, which means if you have a situation like that and you know that's happening, you need to call, you need to reach out and call the people and say, how are you doing? Let's talk. Because we think they'll be okay in about 3 months. No, they won't. No, at 3 months, it intensifies again, just like at a year and other anniversaries. And so we need to be sensitive to that. A young pastor taught me something one time. when he said, after I do a family service, memorial service, I go back to my office and I put that name of the family on my calendar every 3 months for the next 2 years. I have done that as long as 3 years. It's important. We had a situation where two little boys were murdered by their father, and they had been in a preschool at Lakewood Baptist Church, and there was the remaining mother and a six-month-old baby. That group at the church that took care of the children, the preschool, 31 mothers, banded together and brought Liz and her baby dinner every night for 1 year. Folks, that's ministry. That's ministry. You need a group in the church that has that as their task. And what a way to minister to them. Okay, let's distinguish between loss, crisis, and trauma. Loss. What happens with a loss? There's something missing. It's not there anymore. There's a hole, and it creates an ache, an emptiness, and a sadness. But then there's a crisis. Crisis throws us off balance and into a state of shock, panic, and uncertainty. And very honestly, most of the losses that we end up dealing with, it's more of a crisis or a trauma, not just a loss. See, with a loss, you can still function, maybe at 80%, and you can go to work, and you can go to school, and you can take care of things. You're not immobilized, but once you move into the world of the crisis, then you're starting to get immobilized. And then the other part of it, trauma is a wounding. It overwhelms our senses, and it rewires our brain. When you experience trauma, it's like you have both an emotional and a cognitive concussion. Your brain has really been hit, and I'll be getting into this a little later, I hope. What happens to the brain during a loss or trauma? Look at the right side. That's where it's impacted. Left side is not impacted that much. But with a crisis, it's both the right and the left side that's impacted. And then, when you hit trauma, that trauma can actually change your brain chemistry. There's a memory deficit, damage to the brain structure. Trauma separates the left and the right side of the brain, and one of the tasks that you have is trying to bring the two of those back together. Okay, I'm going to run through these losses of life because it's important that we understand what the losses are and how to respond to them. And you've got a place where you can fill this in. Real or material losses. This is usually the first loss as a child. And what does a child hear from the parents when they've lost something? Don't cry about it. We'll go down and get a new one. So what are they taught about grief? They're taught about replacing it and don't share your emotions. And we've started the process for them not to move through life dealing with this stuff. Many are replaceable, which could mask the grief reaction. These are pictures of Katrina. What's going on now in Baton Rouge is worse than Katrina. We had 9 miles on the Ninth Ward of this devastation. You see the picture of the house? In order to stick our head in there and take a picture, we had to be masked, and if we went in there, we had to have a hazmat on. It was that bad down there. And so material goods, they're very important. We're dealing with hundreds of families right now out in California whose home or mobile home is totally destroyed. They're sifting, trying to find maybe a ring or a piece of furniture or something. And their whole life is just destroyed. There's abstract losses. Loss of love, hope, ambition, control, the loss of face. Okay, everybody here be honest. How many of you have ever lost love in a relationship? Let's see the hand. And the rest of you, are you alive? Okay. What is loss of face? What is that? Anybody got a suggestion? Yes, ma'am. It's what? Okay. Loss of face. Public embarrassment. Shame. This at Talbot Graduate School, We have 1,300 students. 55% of our student body are Asian. The majority are Korean. Komapsonida, Anyan Hasanika. Loss of face is very big in their culture. And you know what loss of face is? Getting an A minus on a test. You've got to understand the culture. Could be public embarrassment. Somebody in your town that's very well noted gets a DUI. They're on the front page of the paper. That is loss of face. And it's a big loss. Kind of hard to wrap yourself around it. Imagine a perceived loss. We think the other person no longer loves us. An elderly woman complained that her children have abandoned her. If my children loved me, they would come and visit me every week. Oh, where do they live? 400 miles away. You know, very unrealistic. It's that expectation that needs to be evaluated. And there's also what we call perceived losses. We grieve for something that we never had or never will have, which represents our perceived failure to bond. Examples, relationship we had with an alcoholic mother that we never got, or a brother who died in a war, an education never acquired, a dream of a lifestyle that never achieved. Those are real losses to those people, but other people that don't have them, they don't understand. That's the problem. A company's financial reverses and the resultant changes often contribute directly to the loss of dreams, not only for the employees, but for the families affected. We have a lot of oil workers up in Bakersfield. It's been shut down pretty much. A lot of people experiencing these losses. Relationship loss. The end of an opportunity to relate. Death, divorce, moving, end of friendship. Let me give you several of mine. This was Sheffield, my first golden retriever. Very sharp dog. I used him as a therapy dog with individuals and also in the rest home. And we taught him how to pick things up off the floor. We'd throw on the floor. We'd say, trash. He'd go over, pick it up, went over and put it in the trash. Also taught him how to answer the phone. I'd say, Sheffield, answer the phone. He'd go over and bring it back. People thought it was an obscene phone call in the reverse, you know. Gee. But the day he died, and the description of it was very, very miserable. A very difficult death. This is Matt. One of my best friend's son. I knew him since his birth, took him fishing, really involved with him. Very sharp young man at 23, though he got into the dark side of his mind one night and took a gun and killed himself. And I'll never forget, you ever had a situation where you remember where you were? It's like you're standing outside of yourself and looking at yourself. Well, I was walking at the Relay for Life cancer program where my wife was walking, and I got a call from my friend, and he said, Matt's in heaven. What are you talking about? Matthew's with the Lord. And I can see myself standing there listening and determining not to tell my wife until we got home. And I went back 2 months later and spent a lot of time with him and the rest of the family. That's my wife, Tess, and her mom. Her mom died 2.5 years ago, and it's like she just died yesterday. The loss of a woman's mother is very, very difficult. It's my daughter, Cheryl, who died 1.5 years ago at the age of 53. So I'm still in process and will be for a long time. Intrapsychic loss. Losing an image of oneself, losing what might have been, death of a dream, loss of face. Let me show you a picture and see if you can figure this out. What's the loss? Anybody have a suggestion? Yes, ma'am. His last time as a wrestler. Randolph Gardner, who won the gold in Australia for the Olympics, and the next time at this one, he wasn't expected to be there because he was almost killed in an automobile accident, but he came back and he won the bronze. And to indicate that he was now retiring, he took his shoes off and put them in the circle, which is what you do as a wrestler, and walked away. Very moving experience. but a major loss. I can no longer call myself the heavyweight wrestler. Functional loss. Muscular or neurological functions. Sight, hearing, coordination, body part. I forgot the last one. Memory. Oh, yeah. Diagnosis. Disability. Chronic illness. Somebody gave me, let me see where I am on these notes. Yeah. The senility prayer. God grant me the senility to forget the people I never liked anyway. The good fortune to run into the ones I do, and the eyesight to tell the difference. Yes. Oh. But you know, as you get older and you lose family, you lose friends. I'm on the a family board at Pepperdine, and Art Linkletter was on that board for several years before he died. And a very sharp guy. He traveled the country speaking even when he was at 93 and 94. Unbelievable. One day we were talking. He says, Norm, I'm 93. I've lost every friend I've ever had to death. And I don't have the time left to build new friendships. Wow. And that's what happens as you move on. Okay, role loss, retirement, transfer, promoted, demoted, graduation. People do not prepare for retirement. They just do not realize the multitude of losses they go through. There's systemic loss. This is where a significant person in your group leaves, like a child leaves home or a fellow worker leaves at the office. A family from your church has been there 30 years and they were involved in everything. What about when the pastor leaves? Pastor's been there for 30 years and he retires. Do you lead the congregation in grieving over that? Maybe you need to because it is a major loss. Or what happens if the pastor had to leave because of immorality? Not only do they need to grieve, they need debriefing. And I've been called into a number of churches to help with situations like this. We had one church where four different staff members fell within 10 years. And it just about destroyed part of the church ministry. But when there's a significant person that leaves, that's a loss. And sometimes it helps for us just to sit down and write a non-mailed goodbye letter and then sit in a room and read it out loud, whether it's a person, a situation. There's so many things that we could do that with. Threatened loss. You go to the doctor and they say, we need to do a biopsy and we'll let you know in a week. What is your week like? It's terrible. You're just functioning barely. Downscaling, lawsuit, terrorism, hurricane, tornado, floods. Like last night, the tornado warnings and everything. I'm looking all over the place because we've had two tornadoes in the history of Long Beach where I live. One of them was on our street. And took out a bunch of trees and all the trash. And threatened loss. Problem is with threatened loss is that it's very difficult to grieve over. Why? The reality of that occurring is there. And secondly, you have no control over whether it's going to happen or not. So you're a victim. That's what happens in this kind of a loss. Ambiguous loss. And the two main types of ambiguous loss is when you have a loved one who's really alive in your life emotionally and psychologically, but they're gone physically. They could be MIA, they could have run away, they could be homeless, they could have gotten kidnapped, they could have disappeared for some reason, and there's nothing you can do about it. But on the other hand, the other kind of ambiguous loss is when they're there in your family with you, but they are gone emotionally or mentally. Maybe there's a mental illness. Maybe there's anything from stroke to dementia to Alzheimer's, any of that. They're there physically, but they are not there emotionally or mentally. Now, there's a number of others, too. The variations, deployment, abortion, childhood abandonment, physical and emotional, the loss of childhood from physical or sexual abuse, family members in jail. How do you grieve over that? Where's your support system? Because there's the embarrassment that you have that they're in jail. Or chronic illness. How many people in your congregation have a chronic illness? A lot of them. Is that ever addressed? We deal with fibro in our family. Many people do. But where's the support groups for all these? Disenfranchised grief. The grief that people experience when you incur a loss that is not or cannot be openly acknowledged, publicly mourned, or socially supported. Turn to the person next to you and come up with at least two or three losses that would fit under here. You've got 47 seconds. You can begin. All right, thank you. Could I see a couple hands? Yes, right here, good and loud. Childlessness. Inability to have a child. Yes, very good. Somebody else? Yes. You what? You go to church, but you've not accepted the Lord yet. Yes. Thank you. I've not had that one before. What about the loss of a friend? Because we got friends that are closer than some of our relatives. In fact, we've all got relatives that we've inherited, and we wish we'd been left out of the will. You know, we never connect with these people. There's nothing in common, but friends you build. And I've got 7 close male friends that are very significant. They don't live near me, but we're on the phone a lot, and that is so, so important. What about the loss of a pet? That's another one. On your order form, there's a book called, excuse me, Experiencing the Loss of a Family Member. It's about the 6th one down. That book has a chapter on every kind of family member, including the loss of a friend, the loss of a pet. Let me make a suggestion. It's a book you need on your shelf, and you only need one copy. Because if somebody comes in and they have one of those losses that's in the book, you just make a copy of that chapter and you hand it to them. They don't need to buy the whole book because it's not pertaining all of it. So anytime you find something in any of my books that you need to run off and use, do it. That's what they're for. Do not write me. I'm way behind on emails, okay? Just do it. That's what the book is. But that book will be very significant. So sometime get a copy of it, because then you can just run it off and pass it on. Okay. 3 types of disenfranchised grief. The relationship is not recognized. Okay. The loss is not recognized. The griever is not recognized. I've had to do debriefings with mentally challenged individuals. And some people say, well, can they grieve? Oh, yeah. They can grieve. My son had maybe 8 or 9 words. He was born totally mentally retarded, as they called it, and brain damaged. Could he grieve? I don't know, but every now and then he would tear up. And we didn't know whether that was physical pain or an emotional pain. So we need to give people the benefit of a doubt. Okay, sudden loss. I would say the majority of people that are going to come in to see you have experienced a sudden loss. The capacity to cope is diminished because the shock overwhelms them. The loss doesn't make sense. I don't understand this. It shouldn't have happened. Sudden loss or sudden death usually leaves a survivor with a sense of unreality that may last a long time. And I mean long time. Years. We don't talk in terms of weeks or months. We talk in terms of years. Symptoms of acute grief and a physical and emotional shock persist for a prolonged period of time. Yeah. Sudden loss or death fosters a stronger than normal sense of guilt expressed in if only. As you're working with individuals and you don't hear them mention if only, bring it up. Could it be there are times where you say, if only I had done this, if only I hadn't been there? Give them permission to vent, because many times people wonder, is this all right to have this feeling? Is this all right to have this question? Just like the question of God, why? Where were you? If I don't hear the why question, I'll say, are there occasions where you wonder, why did this happen? God, why did you allow this to happen? Oh, yeah. Tell me about it. Give them permission to talk about it. You want to read a classic book. It's by Michael Card, the singer. A Sacred Sorrow, All on Lamenting and the Psalms. I use this as a text. Incredible book. We finally found it back in print. So we got a bunch of them because we require this. A Sacred Sorrow. Okay, where am I? Here I am. In sudden loss or death, the need to blame someone for what happened is extremely strong. I mean, you could end up being blamed. It happens. They want to blame the doctor, the EMT, paramedic, God. Yeah. So tell God how you blame him. One of the adolescents looked at me and said, he'll zap me. Well, he already knows that you feel that way. Oh, okay. And so he was able to talk about it. There's a profound loss of security and confidence in the world, which affects all areas of life and increases many kinds of anxiety. When there's sudden loss, it piques the anxiety. It goes up and the worry goes up. Sudden loss or death often involves medical and legal authorities. And once you get that there, it's going to prolong the grief and prolong the difficulty. It elicits a sense of helplessness on the part of the survivor. The loss cuts across experience in the relationship and tends to highlight, that should be tends, not ends, tends to highlight what was happening at the time of death. Example, let's say we have a married couple and they have a wonderful relationship for 30 years. In the last 3 months, it's been terrible and one of them is killed. They focus on the last 3 months. And it can just be the other way as well. And we have to bring that into balance for them. Sudden loss or death leaves the survivors with many regrets and a sense of unfinished business. In the event of sudden loss or death, there's a need to understand why it happened. And we've talked about this already and that why. Death tends to be followed by a number of major secondary losses because of the consequences or lack of anticipation. And the death can provoke post-traumatic stress disorder. Okay, hang on, let's see where I am. Oh, I found a stress test that I thought would be apropos for all of us here. So let's just take a look at this. Okay, I'm not exactly sure how it works, but it's really accurate. I want you to read the full description before looking at a picture I'm going to show you. The picture below has two identical dolphins in it. And it was used in a case study in stress levels at St. Mary's Hospital and Mercy Hospital and Memorial Hospital in Bakersfield. You look at both dolphins jumping out of the water. They're identical. And a closely monitored scientific study revealed that in spite of the fact that they're identical, if you're under stress, you're going to find differences in the dolphins. The more differences a person finds, the more stress you're experiencing. Look at the photograph, and if you find more than one difference, you may want to take a vacation. Here it is. There you go. What are you laughing at? I mean, I see two dolphins there. Gee, no bull. You know. Oh, well. I'm sorry, I gave you a bump steer on that one. Yeah, I know. So, okay. Secondary loss. Okay, here's where I need your help for a couple minutes. Here's a couple, and the husband dies. And people say, she lost her husband. Yeah, but because she lost her husband, what are all the other losses that she's now facing because of that loss? Turn to the person next to you and come up with at least three. You can begin. Okay, your task is to help people identify secondary losses in advance. Because if we don't, they get ambushed. And each one hits them again and again, and it prolongs. Take a look at this now. Examples of the loss of a spouse, friend, provider, handyman, cook, lover, bill payer, gardener, laundry person, companion, confidant, sports partner, mentor, checkbook balancer, prayer partner, mechanic, source of inspiration or insight, identity. That's just part of them. Teacher, motivator, counselor, business partner, protector, errand person, organizer, encourager, in-law support, couples class, financial adjustment, social adjustment, feeling of safety, tax preparer, couple friends. Wow. Talk about being overwhelmed. But see, this is a big one where they lose their couple friends because you're now single and you're a threat. Nobody says that, but we know that's what's going on. And so whether it's the loss of a spouse, the loss of a parent, the loss of a child. Incidentally, on the loss of a child, there is a book entitled Missing the Child You Love, Finding Hope in the Midst of Death, Disability, or Absence. It covers all three. Okay. This is just to show you, as you work with individuals, there are the 11 losses of life that we've gone through. And one of the things that you can do either in a class or one-on-one is to go through each one and identify what the loss was, and then what did you learn through that experience? Because at some point we move to that place. You see, people ask the question, why? It's okay to ask why, because eventually that question why turns into what can I learn through this? How can I grow through this? And finally, how can God be glorified through this? See, no tragedy is ever wasted in God's economy. He uses it. And I've walked through that, and I believe it, and I've felt it. He will use that. And so you can use something like this with an individual. It will take quite a bit of time, but pretty soon they realize, you know, in spite of all the pain that I went through, this is what I learned. And how can you use that to minister to others? Okay. I want to do a timeline and teach you about this. Let's look at a timeline of grief for Eric Smith. Eric Smith was born in 1964. His first loss was a dog. Then they moved. And then the parents divorced. And then he lost partial vision in his eye. Now, notice how black those are. We black those in because those still impact him. He has not resolved that loss. Then he discovered a tumor in his leg, and it was diagnosed benign. Then his wife miscarried, job transferred to the East Coast. Closest friend died in car accident, mother diagnosed with Alzheimer's. 2001, uncle died in Trade Center, never found. And that's still haunting him. And daughter left for college. Okay. Let me go back. Now, on your paper, you have a place where there is a line. What I'm going to ask you to do is to begin the process of looking at your own loss history. The vertical line, the one going up and down, that indicates the intensity of the loss. That's what. And if you come to a place where you realize that's still impacting me, then put some dots there to indicate that has not been resolved yet. So go ahead and start that process. I'll just give you a few minutes and then show you how to use it at another time as well. Let me interrupt you and ask a question. What are you experiencing right now? What's going on inside of you? Could I see your hand and in a good loud voice, just tell us what's going on inside of you right now? Yes. The sadness is starting to come up. Okay. What else? Yes. Aching. Aching. Anxiety. Whole pile of stuff. Okay? Now see, just in 2 or 3 minutes, it has started to activate some things. Now usually we would take quite a bit longer period of time, but I've got so much to cover that I won't cover anyway. So, but one of the things that we've learned is that this works best if you take the lost history and leave it out at home for a week. And every time something comes to mind, go and write it down. And every now and then stop and look at it, and then something else is going to come up, and you will find it will be much greater completed by doing this. And when you have finished identifying your losses and identifying the ones that are still alive and impacting you, the next step is to go back to the loss history and on the top part of it, do the history of the blessings that you've experienced in your life. Because life is full of both grief and sorrow. Some people live in one or the other, but life is a balance. And by doing this, it does balance it out for you. That's something that you can do. Let me make a recommendation. This book has been out for 1 month. It's called When the Past Won't Let You Go. It's what I have learned about trauma in the last 10 years. Put it together in this book. And I would really encourage you to go through this. When the Past Won't Let You Go. Okay, I'm going to jump ahead to one. Because as we talk about loss, I think it's really important that we have a biblical perspective. Peter said, "Beloved, don't think it strange concerning the fiery trials which try you as though some strange thing happened to you." The Message has a very interesting description. Friends, when life gets really difficult, don't jump to the conclusion that God isn't on the job. Instead, be glad that you're in the very thick of what Christ experienced. This is a spiritual refining process with glory just around the corner. Purpose of loss. This is the verse that my wife, Joyce, and I lived on for 22 years. Count it or consider it all joy, my brethren, when you encounter various trials, for the trying of your faith produces endurance or patience. Some of the commentaries said that this could mean an internal attitude or of heart and mind that causes the trial and circumstance of life to affect us either beneficially or negatively. In other words, there's a choice there. The verb tense means a decisiveness of action, not a passive giving up. It's make up your mind to regard adversities as something to welcome or be glad about. And that does make a difference. In 2 Corinthians, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord, the Father of sympathy, and the God of every consolation and comfort and encouragement, who consoles and comforts and encourages us in every trouble so that we may be able to console, to comfort, and to encourage." Now, when you talk with people about a biblical perspective and the purpose of loss, you don't talk to them about this at the beginning. This could take weeks, it could take months, and it's drawing from them, what have you learned about God at this time? What have you learned about the Word? And the purpose of loss, it can strengthen our faith. Then it can produce maturity. Look at Romans 5 and what it says. As we suffer, we enter into the suffering of our Lord and become more Christ-like. When you experience loss, you will discover the extent of the comfort of God. God can use what you've experienced to help someone else. That's where the passage comes in from 2 Corinthians. Let me tell you about a little boy named Matthew. When Matthew was born, he appeared to be very normal looking. But after a few weeks, my wife said, "You notice when you walk through the room, he doesn't track with us?" And I didn't notice, typical guy, you know. And so we looked, she says, "Well, yeah, that's not a big problem. He's going to catch up." Well, this went on for weeks and months, and he wasn't catching up in any area. He was getting slower and slower. And at 8 months, he had his first grand mal seizure. And they continued. And we put him under the care of the neurologist at UCLA. And Dr. Menske's brought us in and said, the best I can tell you is that for some reason, Matthew's brain did not form properly, which accounts for the severity of the mental retardation. And then at birth, he had damage to his brain, which accounts for seizures. He might become a two-year-old mentally, and then again, he might not. And we were sent home with that. We did not want to become a statistic because 80% of couples who have disabled children divorce. And so we learned. We learned not to take things for granted because it took Matthew 2.5 years to reach out and pick up something, and we thank God for that. It took him 3.5 years to learn to walk. And one night, he's sitting in front of us, and he stood up, took 4 steps, sat down. And I said something really profoundly spiritual. Wow, isn't that great? And so did Joyce. And our daughter, Cheryl, said, why don't we just stop right now and thank God for answering this prayer? My son taught me to be fully human. I was like most men. I was raised emotionally handicapped. I didn't have a feeling vocabulary, and I did not cry. Matthew changed all that. Matthew taught me to listen with my eyes because he had so few words and we had to read him nonverbally. And all of a sudden, something was transforming in my counseling practice. And I heard people in a new way and I responded to them in a new way. And it was my son who did that for me. Why was it that when I went to Fuller Seminary that I violated one of the traditions? I went in and told my professor, I don't know what to write a thesis about. And she said, sit down. Let me tell you what you're going to write on. Write a thesis on the Christian education of the mentally retarded child. And then at Pepperdine, when I had to put in my 500 hours of internship for the school psychologist credential, why did they assign me to test and place the retarded students? Why was it that the church where I was on staff, heard about that and said, why don't we develop a ministry to retarded children and their families, Norm? And I knew what the word we meant. So for 6 months, that's what I did, during which time my wife and I had the most significant conversation of our married life. And it lasted less than 30 seconds. Isn't it interesting? We're having so much exposure to retarded children and learning so much about them. Could it be that God is preparing us for something that's going to occur later on in our life? Huh. That's all we said. A year later, our son was born. And the name Matthew means God's gift or gift from God. And he truly was. And so, when Matthew was about 8, we were dealing with a 65-pound infant. And my wife was getting worn out. And we wondered, what's best for us as a family? What's best for Matthew? And so we felt led to place him. And through a whole series of delays, God worked out all our emotional issues so that when we took him out and said goodbye and couldn't see him for 6 weeks, we had such peace and calm. We had concern that he might forget us, but he never forgot us. When he came home, he learned some things. He learned how to feed himself. Put him at the table, 3 bites out of 5 hit the mouth, 2 bites hit the floor, and the 2 Shelties were sitting there just, yes, Matthew's home, yes. But the greatest gift that Matthew gave to us was that he had learned something new. See, for 15 years, we would reach out and hug him. Nothing. We'd say, Matthew, hug. Nothing. And then something happened where we'd say, Matthew, hug, and he'd open his arms. Maybe twice a year, we'd get a hug from him. And let me tell you, when you've gone for 15 years without, how precious that is. Every one of you here today has that ability to reach out and hold and hug somebody, even if you were raised in a home that was not demonstrative, because God reached down and enveloped you in his arms and hugged you to him through his son, Jesus. You can hug others. And that is so important. And for many years, that's where I stopped telling the story. But But in 1990, we entered into something else. Matthew had reflux esophagitis, the regurgitation, and the esophagus was torn. And the first surgery didn't work very well, so he went into a second surgery. That took a while, and then he was on a striker bed with 8 tubes and a ventilator for a week. And on March 15th, the Ides of March, the hospital called with a very generic statement, "You need to be here as soon as possible." And we were. And walked in, and the doctor said, "Matthew's heart and lungs will stop in the next hour." And I watched the monitors diminish. There's that impending sense of loss. Coupled with the sense of joy reflected in my wife's statement to the doctor, "You mean Matthew will be with Jesus today?" And he smiled. And he said, "Yes, he will." And he was. We attended Hollywood Presbyterian Church at that time. We drove 32 miles each way on Sunday for 13 years to sit under the ministry of Lloyd Ogilvie. And Lloyd spoke at his service. And he said, "Matthew doesn't walk funny anymore. He can run. And he's got a vocabulary." And so when you go through a difficult time, when you are struggling, maybe not now, but at some time God will use that for you and to touch the lives of others. Now let's assume you come in for counseling and you're in loss and you're grieving. After we chat for a while and talk, I'm going to hand you a piece of paper which you will have when you leave, and I encourage you to make multiple copies because it's called The Crazy Feelings of Grief. And I give this to Fred and ask Fred to read it and say, "Do you connect with any of these?" And if Fred is like most people, they'll say, "Yeah, all the above. Where do you get this, Norm? Did you write this up on me?" No, not at all. This is what grief is. This is what we all go through. Really? And then I go through these with him. And let me jump ahead to get that. The Crazy Feelings of Grief, they're a sane response to grief. And when I do debriefings, I use this. I use it all over. I have it laminated. I carry it with me, my Bible. And people are so thankful. And this is why you need to rent it off, because they need to go away with it. And one of the suggestions that I make to them is that, look, when people ask you, "What's going on? You know, what are you struggling with?" Instead of having to tell them, say, "Take a look at this." Hand it to them, let them read it. And I have people that make multiple copies of this so they carry it around and they don't have to always go into what's going on in their life. And it's a benefit. So here they are. Distorted thinking patterns, crazy feelings, irrational thoughts, fearful thoughts. People say, "Yeah, I'm full of them." And they might stop and want to talk about these. Feelings of despair and hopelessness. Out of control emotions, they're raging all over the place, or they're numb, they don't feel, and it can fluctuate back and forth during the day. Changes in sensory perceptions, things just don't taste good anymore. Yeah, they don't. Increased irritability, may want to talk a lot or not at all. And that's what throws other people, because one day they're gabbing all over the place and you come back and assume that's what they want to do. They don't want to say a word. That's grief talking. Memory lags and mental short circuits. They're talking and say, "What were we talking about?" I mean, that even happens to me. I'll be asking somebody a question in counseling, and they go on for 5 minutes, and then they stop and say, "Norm, what was your question?" And I hope to heaven I remember. And if I don't, I say, "Oh, keep on talking. You're doing fine." Or, "What do you remember hearing me ask you?" You know. Oh, inability to concentrate. Oh, we had a shooting at one of the high schools at Taft 4 years ago, and a boy walked into the classroom with a shotgun and shot another student in front of 22 other students, and I ended up working with that class for a year and a half, one day a week. And that was quite an experience in itself. I remember several of the students saying, "Norm, I had studied. I knew all the stuff up to the point of the shooting. And it was like somebody took a giant eraser and wiped it clean. I don't remember a thing." And I had to make contact with teachers and say, "You've got to back off on pressuring these students because they're not going to be learning much the rest of the year. Eventually, it'll come back, but not now." And if you haven't worked with high school kids for a while, you're in for a treat because they are all over the place. And but they grew, and there was healing that occurred. But that was a whole nother story. But that inability to concentrate, it's there. Obsessive focus on the loved one, they can't get their mind off of them. They're just there all the time. Losing track of time, increase or decrease of appetite and or sexual desire, difficulty falling or staying asleep. I'm going to come back to this one. Dreams in which the deceased seems to visit the griever. Nightmares in which death themes are repeated. Let's say that you're working with somebody and they say, "I have this repetitive nightmare and it just really is destroying me." One of the ways that you can help people with their nightmares is to have them sit down and handwrite out the nightmare. And then when they come to the conclusion, put in a positive conclusion. I don't know why it works. It seems to work for many individuals that they broke the cycle and the control of that nightmare by changing the ending. So that is something that could be done. Physical illness like the flu, headaches, or other maladies. You need to talk to them about what they're eating, what they're drinking, their exercise, et cetera, et cetera. And watch out for where the germs are. They need to carry that stuff and rub their hands. Railings are one of the worst places. Your cell phone is the most germ-laden object that you have because you pick it up 20 times a day, and every time you pick it up, the germs that are on your hand went to it. What I do in the fall and in the winter when I go to church, I carry my Bible in my right hand, and when I get to the greeter, I let him just bump it. I don't want to shake his hand because if I shake his hand, I've shaken the hand of 100 people, and I got all those germs. That's not being OCD or anything, but it's just being practical is what it is. Shattered beliefs about life, the world, and even God. Be sure that you run off this crazy feelings of grief. You've got all sorts of stuff to run off out there. And that, along with the experiencing grief, will be the resources that you will give, along with the DVD and everything. And we'll talk about this a little later. Okay, sleep. When you lie down, you shall not be afraid. You shall lie down and your sleep shall be sweet. You will not be afraid when you go to bed, and you will sleep soundly through the night. If I'm sleepless at midnight, I spend the hours in grateful reflection. Okay, you've got all these scriptures printed out for you. In a dream, a vision of the night, when sound sleep falls on men, then he opens the ears of men and seals their instruction. So we have these scriptures, and we also have this prayer. Dear God, we give thanks for the darkness of the night wherein lies the world of dreams. Guide us closer to our dreams so that we may be nourished by them. Give us good dreams and memory of them so that we may carry their poetry and mystery into our daily lives. Grant us deep and restful sleep that we may wake refreshed with strength enough to renew a world grown tired. We give thanks for the inspiration of stars, the dignity of the moon, and the lullabies of crickets and frogs. Let us restore the night and reclaim it as a sanctuary of peace, where silence shall be music to our hearts and darkness shall throw light upon our souls. Good night, sweet dreams. It's a beautiful prayer. You will have the scriptures printed out, the prayer printed out. And if you're working with those who say, "I have a hard time getting to sleep at night," or "I wake up and I have insomnia," what they do is they take this listing of scriptures and the prayer, sit by the side of the bed, read these out loud, and then turn off the light, which is The last thing that they're hearing through the auditory, the last thing they're seeing through the visual, is the Word of God giving its promises. And many people have found that they are now capable of going to sleep. You don't watch the bad news of the day just before you go to bed. You don't get involved in something just very intense, but you find the peace that comes from the Word of God and from this prayer. So that's something that you can pass on to them. Okay, let me see where I am. Okay. We can talk about techniques. We can talk about suggestions. But basically, what really happens when you're ministering to somebody in grief, it is your presence. It is you being there, helping them realize that what they have to say is so important. You're tuned into them. Your cell phone is off. You don't answer anything. You're concentrating on them. 3 months after my wife Joyce died, I went to take a blood test at my doctor's, and the PA said, "Dr. Nichols will be in just a minute." I'm thinking, "Well, why is Ed coming in? I didn't have an appointment." He opens the door, comes in, takes one look at me, and I lose it. I mean, I'm all over the place. And he sits down with his hands folded, looking at the floor till I compose myself, and then just starts chatting with me. He talked with me, and we talked together, and we laughed together, and we cried together, and we talked together. This man, who had 60 patients a day and 15 staff to oversee, sat there, connected with me, and after 15 minutes, shook my hand, said, "See you later, Norm," and walked out. And I thought, what a gift. He gave himself. He didn't charge me. He had all these other people to see, but it was his presence. It's your presence that will make such a difference. And to reinforce what you do, 3 things. Tell me your story. I'd like to hear it. And you turn to them and you listen to them. And then you normalize for them what they're experiencing. And they have this sigh of relief. And remember, with people who are in grief, you will probably have to repeat yourself again and again and again. And the people that really need this is when there's been a suicide. I've had 25 families with suicide in the last 4 years. And they'll want to come in and tell their story again. I could lip sync it. But they have the need to say it, and they have the need to have me hear it. And that is so important. Now, there's another way of telling your story. I do a lot of handwriting myself. I write my books longhand, but I have people handwrite out their story. Not computer. Handwrite it, because that's bringing both sides of the brain together. And in doing that, they're able to relinquish it. I made 5 trips back to New York. First 3 trips back on the airplane, I spent about 3 hours handwriting out what I had experienced, what I saw, what I felt, what I did, etc., etc. I did this for 2 reasons. It was my own personal debriefing. And secondly, I knew when I got home, everybody was going to want to know, "Norm, what happened? Tell me about it." And I didn't want to go into a lot of this stuff. And so if they said, "Tell me about it. Thank you for asking. Here." I gave them 5 pages, single space. More than they ever wanted. But I'm a writer, so, you know, that's what happened. But that has been such a way to bring healing to an individual. It really makes a big difference. Then, let's see where I am. Okay, this is something that you will also have. It's called the ball of grief. Best tool I've ever found. I found it 40 years ago. And what I do is I just share this with the person and say, "Do you connect with any of these words?" And they might say, "Oh, yeah, regret and relief." See, relief is one of those feelings that people have, even with deaths, that they say, "Should I feel this or not?" What if the person has been terminally ill for 2 years? There'll be relief for them, there's relief for you. Because if you're a caregiver, you're prone to trauma. And so that needs to be talked about. And as you go through this, confusion, maybe apathy, maybe fear, I might say, hey, Fred, tell me about your confusion. I'd like to hear about it. Think about it. And so he talks about that for maybe 20 minutes. Wow. This prompted it. And what I do, I give this to an individual and say, look, every day is different. So every morning, why don't you just take a look at your ball of grief and see where you are. And don't be surprised if you're at a different place, because we change. When I worked with those kids at Taft High School, once a month, they got a ball of grief. And they had highlighters and crayons, and they filled it in and talked. Man, they get going and going and going. I had a family, Hispanic family, that the oldest boy was killed on a skateboard. Dad was a correction officer, and mom and dad talked really, really well. They were good and articulate, and they came for counseling with the other three teenage boys. And I mean, they were typical boys. Yep. Nope. Yep. Could hardly get a word out of them. The same way at home, they wouldn't talk about their grief or anything, so I sent home five copies of this. Said, after dinner one night, get the crayons out, sit at the table, and go to work. Man, they came back in the next week, and they said, we were there for an hour. We couldn't shut the kids up. And it came into the session. They started talking. It gets people open. It gets them to connect. We've all got stuff going on inside of us, but sometimes we don't have the words for the stuff. And that's what happens. So you use this. I've got this on a laminated card as well, and it just really, really works. Okay. What do you do when you've got somebody who is really upset and they've made an appointment to see you and you know, in about 3 or 4 minutes, they've got to leave, and they're upset. How do you help a person calm down? Turn to the person next to you and take 43 seconds and come up with one suggestion. You can begin now. Thank you for the way you jump in and talk. You are a good live audience. Not that I have dead ones, but you're good and alive. Let me make three suggestions. One of the things that can be done is asking the person to take a deep breath. And we're all going to do this together here as a group. Okay, I'm going to ask you to inhale and then hold it, and I'll tell you when to exhale. Okay, inhale. Exhale. Inhale. Exhale. Inhale, exhale. Okay, I have them do it 12 times because each time takes about 5 seconds, which is 1 minute. And they find that, yeah, I can calm down a little bit. I can relax. That's something that you can do at home, isn't it? See, I like to give homework assignments that are attainable. That are attainable. You want to set them up for success, not for failure. That's critical. Then I might be talking to the person and saying, do you remember the old-fashioned radios? Oh, yeah, yeah. In fact, we even bought one. So it's got those dials on there? Yeah. Remember how we turned the dial to get a different station or to get a different volume? Yeah. Okay. I'm going to have you sit there and just close your eyes. Now, just imagine you're sitting there with a radio like that. That's got that dial, and you feel the little knobs on that thing. Yeah, okay. Now, this is not a real radio, but it's a measure of your feelings. Now, you said earlier that on a scale of 0 to 10, you were really intense, really wired, and really upset. You were at an 8. Yeah, I did. Where would you like to get to? Maybe down to a 4 or 3. Okay. Now, in your mind, see yourself putting your hand out on that little knob on the radio And that's the feeling knob. Now in your mind, start turning it and keep turning it until it goes down to a 7. And you take your time and just keep turning it, and you say, you tell me when it's a 7. Okay? So they're doing this slowly. I'm at a 7, Norm. Okay, good. Just relax now. Now, in your mind, see yourself going to that knob again, slowly turning it till it moves from a 7 down to a 6. And I go through that process all the way down to a 3 or a 2. And for many people, it really, really works. Then, one last suggestion is to teach them how to count backwards from 100 by 7s. So, guess what, folks? We, as a group, are going to count backwards from 100 by 7s out loud. All right? Okay, 100. Let's hear it. 193, 86, 79, 72, 65, 58, 51, 40, 37, 30, 23, 9, 2. Good. You did it very well. Interesting. You know, we can tell whether a person is more visual or auditory or kinesthetic by their eye movements. And a lot of you are visual. Man, your eyes were up like this because you were seeing it in your mind or writing it. But this is something that really works because it can bring a person who's up at an 8 or 9 down to about a 3 or a 2. I've used it with kids who have anxiety over making a speech or being in front of a class, but it works in this way as well. But what did we have you really do? Why did it work? Why did it work? What did we do? Thank you, Fred. He nailed it. We took you from the right side of your brain, the emotional side of the brain, and we put you over into the thinking or logical portion of the brain. We just brought you back. And that's good to be able to do that because usually the left side can't overwhelm the feeling side, the emotional side. But in doing something like this, we just did a gentle shift. And that's something that they can do at home or wherever they are to bring them back. And they realize it's possible for me to move forward. Now, a lot of the other stuff that I had to cover, fortunately, we printed it out. Because in 2 hours, can't cover it all. I'd like about 6, but I'm glad I got 2. Thank you very much. Let me make a suggestion now. One of the things that we do at our conferences, we don't send a ton of books. We send a sample. And then you order whatever you want here. We ship it to you, and there's no postage. And the books will be signed. So you have this order form right here. And you look over and indicate anything that you want. And then you turn it in to me. And if you want to use a credit card, you just fill out all the information on the back here on the credit card. We protect these. They send you a invoice. And we send you all the materials. And you just turn it in here. But let me go through what is important, okay? These two, if you're going to do any kind of work in this area, these are essential. The crisis counseling and the helping those in grief. Then, at your church, if you want to train lay people or deacons or the congregation, what to say when you don't know what to say. Now, there's a chapter in here that gives you that in detail, what to do, what not to do, what to say, what not to say. If you would like to take that chapter, run it off put it in the church bulletin so that everybody has a copy of it. Feel free to do so, because that way it's giving them some handles. The reason people don't reach out and help others, I don't know what to say, or they say the wrong thing. So that's what this book is about. Then a brand new book that we didn't get on there. It just came out, and we got the rights to carry it. It's called Coming Alongside, Basic Pastoral Care at the Bedside. It's 25 years of experience from Jeffrey in being a hospital chaplain and overseeing about 40 other chaplains. Anybody that does any hospital visitation, like your deacons, this is a must. This is loaded with so much material. It's called Coming Alongside. You need to write it on your form. It didn't get on there. It's so new. It's $16, but it's just the best thing so that you will know what to say, what not to say, because there's a lot of protocol at a hospital. I'm part of a victim relief chaplain at the hospital, and we have to be so careful at what we do, what we don't do, and what we say. This book does it. I wish this had been out years ago. Then, I already mentioned some of the others, When the Past Won't Let You Go. Two DVD series. For a number of years, I've gone throughout the country doing a half-day seminar on recovering from loss and grief. We put it on DVD, so I don't have to travel as much, and you don't have to bring me in. You can use this in a seminar setting. You can use it in a weekly class. But we found a lot of churches are using this for shut-ins. They can't get out, you take it to them. There's about 20 pages that can be downloaded from the DVD. So this you can use in any setting possible. And then, along with this book, When the Past Won't Let You Go, there have been two things I really wanted to do as sort of a summation of what I have learned about counseling. One was that book. The other was a series of live counseling sessions, because that is the best way to learn how to counsel. There's 9 sessions in this, helping those in grief, crisis, and trauma. We got permission from 9 people that came in. I had no idea where they were going, what they were going to cover, and we shot it. And so this is the result right here. And what we suggest is that you not only watch it once, you watch it a second time. You watch it a third time, because you will be amazed at what you are missing and not picking up on during the first couple sessions. It's just like you rewind a television program for 5 minutes, and in that 5 minutes you wonder, how'd they put that in there? That wasn't there the first time. It's the same way. But this is the ideal way to learn, is the verbatims and watching live counseling. And so there's other materials out there as well, some for children, some if you have any questions you can ask. But if you want to order the material here, you just take care of it here, because I'll be around for about an hour. And fill out the card material here on the back, or you can use checks. And that's it. I wish I had more time, but thank you for being such an attentive audience. And let me just mention one last thing. I grew up at the Hollywood Presbyterian Church. They had a Christian ed director there by the name of Dr. Henrietta Mears, a very dynamic woman. She founded Forest Home, one of the major conference grounds in this country. She founded Gospel Light Publishers, one of the main Christian publishers. Under her ministry, 400 men and women went into full-time ministry. Bill Bright, Campus Crusade, Russia for Christ, ministries all over the world. We had a motto across the front of the church, or the classroom, and it was basically this, and it's what I leave with you for all of us to follow. And that motto was, to know Christ, to make him known. To know Christ, to make him known. And as we sit with those at the worst time of their life. That is still what we are doing. Because there will be the time that comes as you sit with somebody, as we often ask, do you have a faith? Do you have any kind of a church background? And even with a non-believer asking the question, would you mind if I prayed with you? I can do either. I can pray or I don't have to pray. I wouldn't be offended. What would you prefer? Oh, no. Because the books I hand out are books from a Christian faith. And I let them know that. Would that be all right if it's from a faith? Oh, sure, I can handle that. Okay. If you get any questions, ask. Just ask. Thank you for coming.